Hobbies Board demanded to cash bail in Philadelphia, and it's been organized by a number of really wonderful groups, and I want to thank them all. There's somebody who's close to you. Got into trouble over the weekend. They did something stupid, or they're just the wrong place at the wrong time, and they got arrested. And that person in Philadelphia would go to either the roundhouse or one of the districts, police districts, and they would sit for anywhere up to 24 hours waiting to see a bail commissioner who would set their bail to determine if they went home while they awaited the trial to determine if they were actually guilty or not. Now, imagine if that was a person such as myself or someone who's close to me, because I have a fairly decent income. That bail commissioner, if they were to set that bail at, say, $1,000, which is not considered high bail in the city of Philadelphia, if they were to set that bail at $1,000, I could go to the bank and I could get that person out of jail. But if that person lived paycheck to paycheck, if that person needed their paycheck to pay their bills and they had no money in the bank, they wouldn't get out. And guess what would happen? On Monday morning, they wouldn't make it to work. And when they didn't make it to work on Tuesday morning, they lose their job. And when they lose their job, they lose their car. When they lose their car, they lose their ability to get around. And the next thing you know, they lose their house. And what's the difference between that person and the person I care about? I have money and they don't. It's the only difference. So we need to end this system. We need to come up with a better system.
My name is Josh. I work for an organization called Youth Art and Self-Empowerment Project. We're a youth-led organization that goes to the Philadelphia adult jails. We do art and poetry workshops every weekend with young men and women that are charged with adults. So I start, as we also employ young people to organize, upon their release, we train them to challenge the laws that allow them to be charged with adults in the first place. I started off as a participant in the workshop, so I was locked up in charge of adults, and I was held for 18 months in my case, was dismissed, and then I got out, and then, so I sat down with a couple of other co-founders of the organization, and we thought about ways that we could help young people stay out of jail and, you know, change their lives. So what we did, we came up with the motto to go into the jail, do the art and poetry workshop, and then employ them as organizers, and hire them as organizers when they come out. Doing this for 10 years, so it's been really good, and we actually helped a lot of young people change their lives around. So basically my story is, was locked up at the age of 16, hanging around the wrong crowd, got caught up, and I ended up getting locked up. The crazy thing about my case is, and I always tell this part of the story, that all the time I went to court, I was in court alone. I didn't have anybody there to help me or give me advice on what I should do, if I should take a bill, or should I plead out, or whatever. So my day of trial, my lawyer came in, he was like, look, you've been locked up for 18 months, they don't have anything, well, they said, you've been locked up for 18 months, the guy is here, we go to trial, we're going to lose. So this is what they're offering you time served, you get out today, and you got 5 years probation. What the other guy did? But I didn't take it only because I participated in the workshop that I do now and go to the jail, and they kind of inform me about the system. So the education that I received is helping me make a better decision when I went into the room with my attorney. But the funny thing is, because the same attorney, he went in there and told my family that I would get out of there, so they had nothing on me to get out. So these are the type of bad things that are going on in our system. Also, I was going to lock up for $2,000 for 18 months. $2,000. I went to court over 30 times. The new case wasn't anything. They could have been like, let me out of office. They could have did a number of things to get me out of that system and staying there, but they didn't. Then also, when I got out, I had to go to school. I tried to get back to school. They wouldn't let me back to school because I was hurt. So. But then also, I would go out and apply for a job. They wouldn't let me get a job because they said I was charged with adult and I had this on my record, even though I was convicted. So these are barriers that are put on people when they're coming out of jail. Also, with no guidance, that comes up in the neighborhood where he had no support, no mentors, what do you think that young person would end up doing? How do you think it would turn out? What we need to do, we got to rebuild our communities. Our communities are disconnected. We don't have community support because we don't know each other.
Yes.
We care of each other.
Yes.
Our media, the news, they're making us scared of each other.
Yes.
We don't go next door and say, how you doing here? What's going on with you? We don't do that anymore because we're watching the news and watching media. Mm-hmm. And it's messing our brains up so we think about success and we can make it all up. As communities, we gotta bring love back.
Yes.
That's what we're missing.
Yes.
That's the only thing we're missing. We gotta bring that caring, wanting to learn about people, wanting to help people. We can all be successful. But can we all be successful as a society?
Yes.
People step on each other back to be successful. This is the problem with our society. We're looking at the wrong thing. We're not connecting with each other. But it's all because of the system. The system is not.
Absolutely.
They underfund education in our community. They overfund policing. And then they wonder why young people make bad decisions. No playgrounds, no rec centers. What do you think young people are going to do if they're around negative influences? They're going to do negative things. So what our position, we go into the jails, we go into the community, we go into schools. We teach young people how to be active so they can have the skills that they need so that they can overcome these obstacles. This is a subject that's not permanent. This is what we need to be taught. Some adults need to be taught this.
Yes.
How to change policy.
Yes.
How to stand for our community. Also, we have to come together and we have to start talking again. And we have to love each other again. We got to understand, through God, everything will be all right. It's not all about the hustle and bustle of working and being successful. That comes automatically. What we do, we need to do, we got to reconnect as a community. We got to love each other out. Now, I hope all of y'all can go back there and sign the petition to end cash bail. Because what the bail does, it holds people in jail for a long period of time. And then that's what happened to me, happens to everybody, even adults and young people. They try to get you to plea out. You stay there for 18 months. Most people would have left if they were in there for 18 months and they didn't have the money to hire a good legal counsel, they would have left. And that's what's going on. That's why our system is 90% conviction rate. Because everybody's clean out, nobody's going to trial because nobody has money because they're held on high bells and they can't afford to go to trial. But then also you have this situation tearing down families and communities because getting out dads in jail. Now mom got to get a job. Now mom is neglecting kids because she can't take care of kids. Now the kids are on the street. Now they're getting locked up. And it's a vicious cycle that's going on and we have to stop it. So go back there, sign the cash bail petition, also sign a petition to repeal Act 33. Act 33 is the law that allows them to be automatically charged with adults. And adults go, of course, pre-trial, so they're not convicted. And it's the same situation that happened with me. Locked up for 18 months, then my case was missing. They didn't reimburse me for that time. They didn't care about what happened with me. They let me go out on the street with no resources or anything to help me in my transition. Now, if I didn't have the support that I had from the organization that I started, then I would probably do it back out. So I'm showing y'all, what I'm here today to say is it's possible for people to change. We just have to create nurturing communities for people to change.
Yes, 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 yes. Yes.
It does work in Washington, D.C., I can tell you that. As of last Friday, our jail is at about 53% of its capacity. We've been operating under capacity for at least the last 8 to 10 years that I've been in pretrial.
Nice.
I can also tell you there is nobody sitting in the D.C. jail tonight on the cash bail that has been imposed by a judge that is keeping that person locked up. We do not use money at all. In fact, on any given day, we at pretrial supervise about 4,500 defendants who have been released from anything on personal recognizance to our highest intensity supervision, which involves the placement of a GPS device on them, or any number of conditions in between. And it's because our judges and our prosecutors and our defense attorneys have all come to rely upon our statutory framework that says persons who have been arrested shall be released under the least restrictive conditions possible. We take that very, very seriously.
Nice.
We do have individuals who have been deemed to be too dangerous by a judge following an adversarial hearing who will say, I am going to hold you without bond because you are too dangerous. However, the trade-off is those persons have their trial within 100 days, not 18 months. Way you just heard from Ruben. Our system does have its issues. There's no question about it, because we are dealing with human beings, and just because a person may have a case pending, he or she may go out and do something which he or she should not do. And then who do you think the Washington Post calls immediately to say, pre-trial, why did you screw up? They called me. It's not a question of screwing up, it's a question of abiding by that law, which is persons who have been arrested, persons who are presumed innocent, should be entitled to release, either on their personal recognizance or under the least restrictive conditions possible. And that's what we do in Washington. Now, our agency is fortunate. We are a federal law enforcement agency. We do have resources that have been approved through the Office of Management and Budget. We are part of the executive branch, so our funding does come from Congress. However, we have not always been a federal agency. We have not always had the great resources that we currently have. I would suggest any jurisdiction can do what we do if they have the will and they have the support of the community to make the changes that need to be made. Our system changed back in 1992. I was a prosecutor at the time. We saw a rise in violent crime in D.C. where we were the murder capital of the world. And it was because our individual defendants who were charged with violent crimes were able to post $10,000, $20,000, $50,000 bail, and they were getting out and they were engaging in continued violent conduct. Our laws changed back in 1992 to where preventive detention became the norm for the violent person, but everybody else was entitled to release. There was a statutory provision included in that change that said, financial conditions shall not be imposed by a judge in order to assure community safety. People who are dangerous need to be held, and a money system is never, ever going to get around that. But it is also much too easy for judges to simply say, $5,000 bail for this offense, $10,000 bail for that offense, because nobody is challenging what that decision is. As I mentioned, in Washington, if a person is going to be held, there has to be a hearing where a defense counsel is able to challenge the government's evidence, and it's up to the judge to make that individual decision. In D.C., 5 to 6% of our arrested population ends up being detained for the life of their case. 5 to 6% only. The other 95 to 94%, they're being released. And they succeed well on this. We have met several times with the council. We've had a number of visitors coming down to D.C., not just from Philadelphia, but also from other jurisdictions, trying to figure out how can we make this change? How can we do what you're doing in Washington, D.C.? Don't get stuck with the resources. What you need is a commitment. You need a culture change, starting with your judges, your prosecutors, but it could be driven by the community to say, we will not allow for this inequity, this basic unfairness to continue, because it really is a tragic, tragic loss for the community, and typically the communities of color are the ones who suffer the most from it. So again, I applaud the efforts that Philadelphia is continuing to do under the leadership of Councilmember Jones, and I understand the MacArthur Foundation has, you know, generated some funding for this. I would urge you to keep up the good efforts that you're doing, but don't assume it's too big of a battle for you to undertake yourself, and hold your judges, hold your legislature, hold your criminal justice system responsible for doing the right thing.
Yes.
I'm finding so many different mentalities today. It seems challenging. I don't say hard, because the only thing hard is being concrete that you walk on. Everything else is a challenge.